Hi everyone, my name is Alexa Elliott. I'm the series producer for Changing Seas at South Florida PBS, and we're really excited to be co-hosting tonight's event with the ANGARI Foundation, which supports marine science education and research. As part of tonight's panel, we have a great group of experts on hand. They are Dr. Craig Dahlgren. He's the executive director of the Perry Institute for Marine Science, and he's here together with his colleague, senior scientist, Dr. Krista Sherman. Also with us tonight is Todd Boyce, the executive director of Abaco Bay's Friends of the Environment. And then we have with us tonight Dr. Charlotte Dunn, she's the president of the Bahamas Marine Mammal Research Organization, which is also based in Abaco. And she's joining us together with her executive director, Dr. Diane Claridge. So welcome, everyone. So nice to have you guys.
Thank you.
Just a quick heads up to our audience. Sorry about that. Just a quick heads up to our audience. Go ahead and feel free to post your questions in the comments section, and our experts will answer them a little later in the program. Now, it's been a little over a year since Hurricane Dorian first made landfall in the Bahamas. Let's take a quick look back.
In August 2019, a tropical system began brewing in the Atlantic. Within days, it grew into powerful Category 5 Hurricane Dorian, which on September 1st would bring devastating winds and storm surge to Abaco and Grand Bahama Islands in the Bahamas. According to the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, the historic storm unleashed maximum sustained winds of 185 miles per hour, with gusts reaching up to 220 miles per hour as it made landfall in Elbow Key in Abaco. Matched only by the Labor Day hurricane of 1935, which hit the Florida Keys, Dorian ties as the strongest hurricane on record to make landfall in the Atlantic. The devastating storm set over the Bahamas for 3 days before moving toward the east coast of the United States. It is estimated that hundreds of lives were lost, with many people still missing today. The destruction from the powerful winds and unrelenting storm surge that reached up to 20 feet in height was catastrophic, making Hurricane Dorian the worst disaster in the island nation's history.
Now, Shah, let's start off with you. I know you were on Elbow Key when Dorian made landfall. Can you tell us a little bit about that day and how the impacts of the storms can still be felt today?
Yes, though, that little video brings back a lot of horrible memories of that day, and I was on Elbow Key. So we knew that this bad hurricane was coming, and people were preparing as they do for hurricanes, and stocking up and with supplies and boarding up their houses, and hunkering down and getting ready for the day. Nobody could ever have imagined the devastation. During the eye of the storm that's calm, we were able to go outside and we realized how bad it really was. With our neighbors' houses have been completely flattened by a tornado and water levels rising, but no one had ever seen it before. There was no way to really prepare for what we had seen. After the initial shock and the realization that many lives were lost and the magnitude of the destruction, people started realizing that housing was limited, that most of the schools and medical facilities, grocery stores, banks, and all businesses were damaged, if not completely destroyed. And it would be a long time before electricity was installed, before a lot of people could even find housing. And so people that needed medical help and families with school children started evacuating. And they started leaving, not even knowing what the future would hold. And here we are a year later and adding COVID to the mix. And many people are still struggling, lack of shelter, and some people, there's people who still don't have running water or electricity. At Friends of the Environment, we lost our education center and our office building. We do have also the Frank Kenyon Center, which is a research center, and that was only minimally damaged. So we were happy to be able to offer a dry space for some relief efforts that were coming in. And things are slowly getting back. Great relief efforts have come in to help do so much. You never imagined, though, that you would live in a place that, you know, for the first several months, you would be eating out of food kitchens, and these efforts would have to come, international people would have to come in and help rebuild schools and homes and whatnot.
Yeah, I can tell you as Floridians, our hearts were going out to all of you in the Bahamas. You know, watching from afar, just seeing Dorian sitting over the islands for several days was just absolutely heartbreaking. And I'm truly sorry for all the loss and devastation that it brought to the Bahamas. I know that your organization, the Friends of the Environment, has long been involved with educational outreach, you know, to support community conservation and sustainability efforts. And I saw on your website that you mentioned that more than 30 years worth of garbage was created from just that one storm. And of course, that it's almost unimaginable when you're on an island and trying to get rid of all that trash. So, the problems that creates, not just for people, but of course also the environment. How did you guys get involved with some of the cleanup efforts? You know, what exactly does that entail and how do you go about that?
Well, not long after the storm, our team started focusing on how we could help with relief efforts. And it was early on that Friends team members attended the United Nations development programs on debris. They had these debris meetings. Our concerns did revolve around the disposal of the debris and the possible health risks for the people and for the environment. We were seriously concerned about the reefs and the mangroves of significant concern was a near shore reef of the near shore reef of Mermaid Reef. That's one of the most popular field trip areas that we take students to in our education program. It's also a really significant site for coral scientists. We had reports that debris was covering that reef, and we were concerned again with contaminants and the health of the corals, because they were also affected by the contaminants, but also because so much debris had come onto the reef and broken up the corals. Even huge casuarina trees had fallen into the sea and been pushed over the reef and had broken up some of the coral. So in January, we were able to put together a week-long debris removal project at Mermaid Reef. We worked with local dive operators and trucking companies, and also a U.S.-based nonprofit organization, Eco-Blue Project. The team got together and dove on the reef, removed, you can see in this picture here, piled debris on boats and or swam it into the beach. And it seriously took days the reef isn't that big, but it took days to get the debris off of that reef. And then it was trucked from the beach there to the two debris sites that were on the mainland. And part of the project also, we were able to bring in school children, which you saw in one of those pictures there, to help with loading up the debris. And these kids come out, that part of our program is we'll take them there, and many of them have never put on a mask and snorkel and looked under the surface of the water before. So a lot of them, the first time seeing under the water is at Mermaid Reef. So it was really impactful for these kids, and they were excited to be able to come out and help at remove the debris at Mermaid Reef and help with relief efforts. Everybody wanted to help. And so it was a really, really cool way to get the kids involved with efforts and at a place that was really important to them.
What a wonderful way to get the community involved too. I know, aside from the obvious destruction that this trash leaves in the ocean, what are some of the other concerns that you have with having all this stuff out on the reef?
I think back to the other question you were asking me, with the debris being such a concern for so many reasons, and there really isn't a definitive answer on what will happen to the debris that's piled up and on these two sites that on the mainland of Abaco. Again, the United Nations Development Program is in discussions on how all this will be handled. Because of the toxins associated with the debris, burning it could cause long-term health effects. And there's also concerns with the water contaminants. And these concerns have been voiced. They're parts of ongoing discussions. It's a really big problem, and there's not really a clear answer going forward as to what will actually happen. But it's important to stay involved with these conversations going forward. But not only are there concerns with the land debris, there's also a lot of marine debris all through the Sea of Abaco, and this also contributes to the loss of mangroves and corals and seagrasses that would protect the island from future storms. And it also losing these areas is also a loss of habitat for many sea creatures. And all of these areas are also important in the world because they're important for carbon sequestration. And locally, it's a big concern because the debris also is a concern for navigational hazards for boaters. And the contaminants caused by the marine debris can also affect the fish, and which also ultimately affects the sea life that we consume. So we are currently working with a team that includes the UNDP Idea Relief, which is a great relief organization, nonprofit, along with BIMRO and the Perry Institute to solidify some plans for raising funds and securing vessels and physical labor for getting marine debris removed. Hopefully this is all going to be happening in the not too distant future.
Yeah, and you brought up a good point, which is, you know, the nearshore habitats such as coral reefs, and you guys working together with the Perry Institute, which I know, Craig, you guys have done extensive monitoring on the reefs around Grand Bahama Island and Abaco Island before Hurricane Dorian hit. Can you tell us a little bit about that research?
Yeah, sure. So I'd been involved with some in-depth studies of reefs and some coral restoration work around Abaco for about 10 years now, working on restoration of some of the reefs in southern Abaco near where Charlotte and Diane live, and some in-depth studies of reefs like Mermaid Reef that Shaw was just talking about, and another reef nearby, Sandy Key Reef, that has some of the highest of living coral cover that we've seen in the Bahamas, and were uniquely adapted to tolerate extreme temperature conditions and things like that. So they were some really unique and important reefs. But starting in around November 2018, we really wanted to get a much broader view of the reefs around Abaco. And I think you were showing a map there that shows we decided to launch an expedition on the research vessel ANGARI and see reefs throughout Abaco and Grand Bahama that are shown on the map. So we did thorough reef health assessments of about 70 sites around the Little Bahama Bank, so Abaco and Grand Bahama, looking at how much live coral there was on reefs, what the condition of those corals were they diseased, were they bleached, were they healthy, and also looking at fish populations and other aspects of reef health that we've been measuring in other parts of the Bahamas for the past 5 or 10 years or so. So we finished those assessments about a month before Hurricane Dorian hit. So we were in a very good position then to know what things were like right before the storm hit. And then we were able to go back after the storm and see how the storm affected those reefs.
Yeah, and just, you know, mentioning that you were able to go back after the storm, if I understand correctly, it was just 6 weeks after Dorian that you guys were able to go back out on the RV ANGARI. Krista, tell us a little bit about what you found when you went back.
Right. So as Craig mentioned, we went back to some of these sites that we had surveyed previously. So we had pre-existing data for it, and we're able to survey most of those same sites again. And one of the really shocking things, especially in some of the sites closest to shore, was the amount of physical damage to the reefs. And that damage ranged from human or anthropogenic or sources of debris. We saw all kinds of things that you typically do not see on reefs, in addition to the natural sources of debris, like the casuarina trees, which are invasive, that Shaw mentioned earlier. But it was quite variable, and we also had some reefs where we saw minimal physical damage to the reef itself. So it was quite a mix in terms of what we saw, but overall about 30% of the reefs suffered severe damage associated with Hurricane Dorian.
I know Sha mentioned Mermaid Reef earlier, where they worked hard to clean up a lot of the trash we just saw in that video. I know that's a little bit closer inshore. How did that fare in comparison to some of your other sites?
Yeah, so Mermaid Reef, as you mentioned, is one of the closest sites to shore. And I think that's one of the reasons why we saw so much damage. And a lot of it was due to land-based sources of debris. So we had items like vacuum cleaners, pieces of construction and roofing materials, plumbing materials, things like laptop computers, lawnmowers, a real range of debris on the reef. That reef also experienced physical damage as well. So some parts of the reef, like you see here, were intact, but other parts of the reef were damaged. And we saw huge chunks of these Orbicella, which are important reef building colonies, that were actually fragmented. That was something that was really noticeable there, because we're talking about colonies that are over a meter in diameter. So losses to coral cover at that site as a result, direct result of Hurricane Dorian.
And if I understand correctly, you actually had worked on putting together a photo mosaic before and after. Tell us about what a photo mosaic is and what that showed you.
Right. So at a lot of our monitoring sites, as Craig mentioned, we have been collecting thousands of images, which then get stitched together to reconstruct sometimes which sections of the reef look like, or to create 2 or 3D models of individual coral colonies. So we were able to do this at Mermaid Reef before Hurricane Dorian. I think it was about April or May last year. And then we did the same thing again at the same site, the same plot, after Hurricane Dorian. So this is an image of what it looked like before, so you get a sense of the reef structure. What you can see after Dorian is, based on some of the analysis that we did, we lost about 30% coral cover. And some of these colonies, as I mentioned before, were actually picked up, and these are huge coral colonies, and moved 20 to 30 meters away. So it just goes to show you the severity of the storm, the strength of those winds, the storm surges, and the intensity of that hurricane. And that was experienced underwater and created significant damage to reef structure.
Which is absolutely heartbreaking when you think about how long it takes corals to grow to that size. To me, it's really fascinating that you say that 30% of the reefs had significant damage, but other reefs did relatively well. Why do you think that might be?
Yeah, so that was something that is really interesting, and it was really variable. And that's something that we're working on with Dr. Claire Powers from the University of Miami to look at some of the environmental conditions that different reefs experienced during the course of the storm. So not all of those reefs were in the direct path of the storm. Some of them were closer to shore, some of them were offshore. So for example, we also saw some significant damage at some reef sites in the northern part of Abaco as well, where there was not a direct impact. So really trying to understand the differences in those environmental conditions and how that relates to the differences in the reef structure itself. So looking at reef type and complexity. So that's something that we're still working out, but there are possible reasons for the variability that we did see.
You know, and one thing that I know when I talked with you guys in preparation for tonight's event that I found very fascinating is the fact that you found that some of these reefs, I mean, some of the corals actually bleached. Why might that be? Why would corals bleach as a result of the hurricane?
Right. So Krista talked a little bit about the physical damage, but we also saw things like bleaching, like you mentioned. Bleaching is the term we use when corals turn white. So they're normally shades of green or brown or other colors. And that color that they have is due to the fact that they have microscopic single cell algae living inside their tissue, actually, called zooxanthellae. Now this is a symbiotic relationship. So the algae gets a nice home to live in, and the corals get food from photosynthesis from the algae. And most of the food that a lot of these corals are getting is from the zooxanthellae that are living inside of them. But what happens when that relationship between those organisms break down due to some kind of environmental stress usually is that the coral expels the zooxanthellae from its tissue and will then appear white. The coral tissue itself is see-through, so you're looking right through the coral to the limestone underneath. Usually this happens when temperature fluctuates. So corals need a very narrow range of temperatures to live in. When temperatures creep up in the summer, sometimes to 86 degrees Fahrenheit or more, is when bleaching occurs. That's too hot for the zooxanthellae to photosynthesize, or the corals, so will spit the zooxanthellae out. What we saw with Hurricane Dorian, though, was that this was not your usual temperature stress that was causing the bleaching. We were out about a week before the storm hit, and water temperatures were just starting to reach that threshold where they might bleach. But then Hurricane Dorian came and dropped water temperatures overnight to about 75 degrees. So we don't think it was temperature stress that caused corals to bleach on some reefs. The other thing that was interesting is we saw this drop in temperature throughout the area, but only some of the reefs actually had bleaching. So it probably wasn't a temperature shock dropping the temperature that much that caused the bleaching either. What we noticed, though, was that the bleaching was most severe for certain species of corals on some of the deeper sections of reef, where in shallow water they might be okay. The deeper you went, the more bleach they got. And the reefs where this was occurring were reefs where there was a significant amount of sediment moved around by the storm. So in some places, there was just mud from inshore areas that buried the bottom 3 feet or so of the reef under a layer of mud, or sand had been moved away from the reef. And when we looked at some satellite images from right after the storm, we saw that the water, you think about the Bahamas as usually crystal clear water you think of when you think of the water. It was looked like chocolate milk. So what we think was that all this suspended mud and sediment reduced the clarity of the water so that light was not able to penetrate down, especially at deeper depths. So the coral stopped photosynthesizing, the zooxanthellae in the coral stopped photosynthesizing for maybe a week or even 2 weeks. And that was enough, we think, to cause the bleaching that we observed. Now, this may kill the corals that were bleached. We haven't been able to get back out on some of these reefs to check. Some of those corals might recover, or parts of the colonies might recover. But in other cases, colonies that may have been there for hundreds of years might have died in a period of weeks from the storm.
Wow, yeah, it's hard to imagine the waters of the Bahamas being all stirred up and muddy. What about fish? Did the fish populations get impacted at all?
That was also something that was really variable. On most of the reefs, we did not detect any real significant changes in fish populations or the species of fish that were there. But on some reefs, they were like a ghost town after the storm. A lot of the big groupers, the big parrotfish, just were gone. And we're not sure, did they simply move off the reef and hadn't come back yet? Or are they gone for good? Has their habitat changed, or were they killed where they're not going to return? So we're going to have to continue to monitor those reefs over time. Other reefs like Mermaid Reef, I think in one of the video clips, showed a lot of little small juvenile grunts that were on the reef. And they weren't there before the storm. And we were out there literally days before the storm, and those fish were not there. But what we think might have happened as the hurricane damaged seagrass beds and mangroves and other nearshore habitats where those little juvenile fish live, they might have then moved on to the reef structure when they lost their where they should be living at the time. So that's something else that we need to follow up on and look into a little deeper.
Now, how would you expect these reefs will recover? And is there anything that we as humans can do to help them along in that process?
Yeah, so some of the reefs that saw minimal damage, I expect them to recover to the point they were before the storm fairly rapidly. They should, within a year or a couple of years, be able to get to the point where they were before the storm. Even some of those reefs that Krista described, where some of the big branching corals were smashed up and were just fragments shattered on the ground, can recover. Those pieces can reattach to the substrate and start growing out of the seafloor. So some of the reefs, I think, are going to be in good shape. Others are, I think, fundamentally changed for decades or maybe more based on the physical damage to some of these slow-growing coral species, or if the bleaching killed off a lot of coral. But we've been doing a lot of research, particularly in Abaco, on coral restoration and reef rehabilitation, where we can intervene. We can help jumpstart the recovery process. For example, around Abaco, we have a series of coral nurseries where we're growing some of the more critically endangered coral species found in the Bahamas. And surprisingly, most of those nurseries made it through unscathed through the storm. And we're able to take coral from those nurseries and begin to replant them on reefs and help the populations recover. We were also, before the storm, doing a lot of research on coral restoration through larval propagation, where we can collect the spawn of corals when they spawn once or twice a year. Fertilize the eggs in a lab, grow the larvae through some critical stages in the lab, and give them a head start reseeding them. So I think we will be able to intervene. We won't be able to do it on a scale that causes the reefs to recover as quickly as I'd like them to, but we can help restart that recovery process in a few key areas and really give those reefs a chance to recover.
That's really exciting and encouraging news to hear that your nursery survived. Now, I know in addition to coral reefs, one of the other important nearshore habitats include mangroves and seagrasses. And that kind of brings me to Diane and Charlotte. I know usually your focus is on marine mammals, and you did a lot of marine mammal assessments right after Dorian, which we'll talk about in a little bit. But I know you also got involved in some other research after the storm. Tell us a little bit about the seagrass monitoring that you've done since, and what did you exactly look at, and what did you find?
So yeah, seagrass beds like coral reefs are among the Earth's most productive ecosystems. They're hotspots of productivity with diverse and abundant communities of macroalgae and invertebrates and fish. And studies have found that if you have mass destruction to these seagrass beds, that can affect the health of top predators such as coastal dolphins. So we were really interested to know what the extent the marine environment was damaged. We have colleagues, friends of ours, Dr. Stephanie Archer from Louisiana University's Marine Consortium and Dr. Beth Whitman from Florida International University, who had been in Abaco over the past decade studying seagrasses. So we contacted them, and because we were on the ground, we came up with a plan to return to their study sites and replicate their work. So the map here shows the seven sites, the blue circles there, and starting in the south, outside the direct path of the storm, moving north into the storm's path. In contrast to our normal field work, Charlotte and I found ourselves in these shallow mangrove systems, counting turtle grass shoots and measuring the height of canopy within quadrats. We also recorded the presence and abundance of different seagrasses, macroalgae species, to document the diversity within the systems. This work was carried out 3 months after the storm and then again 6 months later. And we have funding to repeat that work in February next year and then again in September, which will mark a 2 month period after the passage of Dorian. But as we feared, we did find some dramatic changes at the sites that were in the direct path or near the direct path of that hurricane. Before the hurricane, the pre-Dorian data showed that turtle grass was a dominant seagrass species. But after the hurricane passed, turtle grass was replaced with other seagrasses, namely shoal grass and manatee grass, which are usually prevalent in areas where there's been dredging or disturbance to the habitat. We don't know what the effect of these changes will be, but we expect that there'll be a decrease in the sediment retention with the turtle grasses removed. And as Craig said, with other storms, and you know, not even a storm of the intensity of Dorian, we may, with the sediment not being held in place as well, then you'll end up with more turbulence, and that can cause harm to reefs and other areas. And that's because turtle grass have a more extensive root system, so they can hold the sediment in place better than those other grasses. We will also expect a decrease in the invertebrate abundance because turtle grass, compared to the other grasses, have a larger biomass, so there's more area for those invertebrates to inhabit. And that, in turn, may lead to a lower abundance of fish. And fish are prey for dolphins, so it may have some long-term effects on the dolphin population.
It's really a saving grace that you guys are locally based and can take over some of these research projects. I know one of the big concerns that came up earlier in the conversation were contaminants, which you know, are a huge concern, of course, for marine mammals, which are at the top of the food chain. What kind of short-term impacts did Hurricane Dorian cause for marine mammals, and what did you find, and what do you expect to find in the long term?
We're going to go talk about the dolphins. I was going to touch base on the oyster project we were doing.
I'm sorry. Yes, you're right. Sorry. Yeah, tell us a little bit about the right. Speaking of contaminants, yes, you had a project to actually study what the contaminants in the water are. Tell us a little bit more about that.
We don't really mind the order. It's just that it would be difficult for the videos.
yeah, definitely.
So we chose oysters to use because oysters filter huge amounts of water, and basically that makes them an excellent study organism to use as a biomonitoring tool. So we went to pristine areas near where we live in South Abaco and to collect wild oysters, which we would then transplant to Marsh Harbour and the path of the storm. So not quite as easy as you think it is getting an oyster off of a mangrove. But anyway, it's beautifully clean oyster. Unfortunately, we then took it to 12 different sites. We put cages of oysters throughout the path of the storm of a varying gradient of destruction. This was previously the Jib Room, where Friends of the Environment used to have their annual reef ball. You can see an extremely destroyed area. These huge surges of water that came in after the and during the storm, when that water receded, it took with it so much debris that went into the water. And Shah and Krista have touched on that. So that debris included household, industrial, chemical, cars, oil, everything you can think of. So what those oysters are doing in the 2 months we would leave them is that as they're filtering the water, they're collecting any contaminants in the water in their soft tissues. So when we would collect them, we shut them, store them in our minus 80 scientific freezer for analysis. We have just got a National Geographic grant to continue that work and also fund that analysis. One of the things we're concerned about, and Shah also mentioned this, is that there's potentially a risk for human exposure. If the oysters have contaminants in their soft tissue, then potentially seafood that we are consuming from the Sea of Abaco will also have it. And so too then will the dolphins.
Yeah, and I know you had mentioned also that it's not even just the garbage that ended up in the ocean itself, but also all the, you know, the rubble that has been burnt in the weeks and months since the disaster, just to kind of get rid of all that large amount of trash. So, you know, speaking about that bioaccumulation and then how that might impact some of the marine mammals, what did you find right after the storm? What do you think might happen in the long term?
Yeah, so intense hurricanes like Dorian can have direct impacts on marine animals like whales and dolphins that have to come to the surface to breathe. And how they breathe in the middle of 185-mile-an-hour winds and the storm surge and wave heights and turbidity and debris flying around. They also can be injured from the debris as well, and some of those injuries may be fatal. And there were some mortalities during Dorian, like this dwarf sperm whale. There were two whales that were discovered dead on the shore within days after the storm. And when we were able to examine this animal, sadly, we found that it had a full-term fetus. But our immediate ability to assess the extent of the direct mortality was limited logistically, as you can imagine. But when we did get up in the air, there was so much debris along the shoreline still that it was really impossible to see anything. So we don't have a true estimate of the number of animals that that died during the storm. However, we are in a good position to assess the short and long-term impacts of Hurricane Dorian on Abaco's coastal bottlenose dolphins. This isn't the best picture, but it's the only photo we have ahead of a dolphin with showing some of the damage from the storm in the background. And we began a study of their abundance over two decades ago, and this work has continued with the due to the dedication of scientists from NOAA Fisheries by taking photographs of each dolphin's dorsal fin. We can track the births and deaths over time and monitor the population status. And using this method, we learned that the number of dolphins using the Sea of Abaco area started declining following a series of hurricanes in the late 1990s. And that decline continued since because the habitat quality changed with increased human uses, overfishing, coastal development, dredging operations, and boat traffic associated with that as well. And we've had more hurricanes as well. And as a result of all of these changes, there's been a 50% decline in the coastal bottlenose dolphin population in the Sea of Abaco over the past 25 years since we started the study. So it's really important to us to know how this population is doing following Dorian and how it will be doing in the long term. So since the storm, we've conducted 25 surveys for dolphins in the Sea of Abaco and found 43% of the dolphins that we localized are individuals that we'd seen before the storm, such as this adult female who actually had a calf since Hurricane Dorian. That's a newborn calf one. But also old animals like this guy who we first identified in 1992, as well as young animals. And all of this is really good news. It seems that the impacts were quite low initially. We also were documenting body condition to look at the signs of nutritional stress and evidence of shark bites too. The last photograph was of a dolphin with a recent shark bite. But so far, it seems that the local dolphin population did not have many direct mortalities. These dolphins have experienced many hurricanes in their lifetimes, sadly, but they may have learned because of those experiences to move away from the storm, so the harm done was lessened. But to capture the longer term effects, we're planning additional surveys throughout the end of this year and hope to get funding to continue this work in future years. But the long-term impacts will depend on the resilience of the ecosystems like the seagrasses and coral reefs, and as well as the contamination level. And it may not all be negative. Not all hurricanes have led to declines after Hurricane Katrina, because the commercial fishing fleet was destroyed. There was less competition between dolphins and fishermen for fish. And so the dolphin population there actually experienced an increase as females had more food and had more cows. We don't know what the impact will be in Abaco, but we'll be watching.
Yeah, it's really nice to hear that you've seen a lot of the dolphins that you've followed over many years before. And, you know, I guess there's a little bit of a silver lining in the fact that, you know, as far as the dolphins are concerned, at least, the fact that there are so many fewer boats in the area now, not just because of the hurricane, but then also because of the pandemic. So tell us a little bit about that.
Okay, well, the storm took out 90% of all the vessels in the Sea of Abaco. So Diane was talking about a reduction in the number of animals using the area. It's very difficult to pin down you know, what is the exact cause of that, but effectively overnight, one of those factors were removed. Vessel traffic was removed from the area. There's two reasons that marine mammals and vessels don't really get on, and one is because vessels hit marine mammals, not meaning to, and the other is because vessels create noise, and marine mammals use noise to find each other, to find mates, to find food, to listen to predators, basically all their life functions. So the noisier their environment is, the harder it is for them to, you know, live as well as they can. There have been studies all around the world about either animals displacing, as they seem to have done in the Sea of Abaco. So moving out of an area as vessel traffic increases, or else changing their behaviors, so reducing their foraging or resting times, which can be detrimental to that population. So what we did, having this, unfortunately, this unique opportunity, was we put out acoustic recorders in the Sea of Abaco immediately after the storm, and we are using these recorders to monitor the change in ambient noise, so the change in vessel noise as the rebuild commences, and also to detect dolphins. We've done some initial analysis. We had a master's student at the University of St. Andrews who has shown that in the first 5 months following the storm, the dolphins continued to be detected more and more. So the dolphins were returning to areas that historically they had been using. As the vessel traffic increased, the dolphin detections leveled off. Then we had the pandemic and the vessel traffic decreased again. And there is beginning to, we're beginning to see a correlation between vessel traffic and dolphin presence as expected. So, you know, we will be doing more research visually, doing dolphin surveys and really try and nail down some areas of importance to dolphins that they're using for foraging or resting. And perhaps before we get back to where we were pre-Dorian with hundreds of high speed vessels using this area as a community, you know, maybe we can agree on some slowdown zones or some areas to avoid that seem to be really important for the dolphins, that those small actions may be able to help this population recover. So there is some good news there.
Yeah, that's good to know that there's at least some positive that has come out of all this tragedy. Now we're getting ready to start taking some audience questions, but first I just want to take a quick moment to thank our generous funders who make the Changing Seas series as well as events like tonight's possible. And that, of course, is the Bachelor Foundation, which has been with us from the very beginning. Also the Arthur Vining Davis Foundations. And then there was a gift made in loving memory of David G. Parrott from the Parrott Family Endowment for Environmental Education. So thanks to all of you for supporting public television. Also, for those of you watching at home, you may have noticed that in the comments, there is an actual survey that you can participate in. We would love to hear from you and get some feedback to see what you like and don't like about these types of virtual events. And a lucky few of you, if you complete the survey, will win some cool swag from the ANGARI Foundation and from Changing Seas. So thank you for that. Now, in terms of audience questions, one thing Amanda is asking, what was the most surprising find for any of you guys doing research once, you know, the storm had passed and you were able to get back out there? Was there anything that really stood out? I don't know if there's one of you who'd like to start.
I'll go ahead and start. For us, it was actually two things. One is that there were some reefs that right off of Elbow Key, right where the eye of the storm made first landfall at its strongest, that we saw little to no damage. It was amazing. And yet just a few miles away, there was reefs that were totally destroyed, like Mermaid Reef. Then the opposite was true. Some of the reefs on the far opposite end of the Little Bahama Bank also saw huge devastation, movement of mud and sand that just buried sections of reef. And yet they were 50, 60 miles away from where the eye passed. And yeah, they got strong winds, but not nearly as bad as some of the other areas. So just the unpredictability of the damage was a big surprise.
Yeah, and just to add on to that, I think one of the most shocking things for me off of Grand Bahama was seeing some of the devastation that the casuarina trees inflicted on the reefs. So it just completely looked like a wasteland compared to what it looked like before. So that was really shocking to just kind of see all these casuarina trees lying on the bottom and the destruction that left. And on the other hand, it was really nice to see all of the coral nurseries that we had out, including some in marine protected areas that were completely intact and healthy. So that was interesting.
I think not shocking, but one of the most pleasing things we saw was when we saw the first calf after the storm.
Yeah.
You know, a real newborn in the Sea of Abaco, and meaning that its mother had been pregnant during the storm and successfully given birth.
Yeah, we also, the last time we were out, actually, we also saw some interesting difference in feeding behavior. We often see frigate birds overhead of bottlenose dolphins because the dolphins feed on jacks and they chase them out of the water, and the frigates dive down and try to steal the jacks from the dolphin. But on this particular day, and I wish we had a photo of it because it was really really crazy looking. There were frigate birds with the dolphins. There are only two dolphins, but there were also about 25 laughing gulls, and they were right over the dolphins, right just above the surface. And you know, every time a dolphin would come up for a breath, there would be a gull there. And it was, you know, are there more gulls there because there's so much debris? And have the gulls just recently learned to feed over dolphins? Or, you know, we don't understand what's happened there, but it was definitely something that we had never seen before in 25 years ago.
Wow, that's really interesting. You know, I guess one thing maybe to explain to our audience, what can happen to dolphins during a hurricane? Like, why would there be potentially mortality if they're not able to get away from the area where the storm is occurring?
Well, it's a very good question. It's really difficult to imagine how they're capable of getting enough air. You know, that surface water interface is going to be so non-distinct. You know?
Yeah.
That how you can get enough air every time you come up to breathe. You know, and it's not something that you can do a test of. You can't set up an experiment to figure that out. But I mean, I think their biggest, their only hope is to get out of the path of the storm. We live 30 miles away from the core of the hurricane. And here we had category 2 strength storm. You know, our trees are all still standing. Everything, you know, we had a hurricane, but compared to what Shaw and people in Marsh Harbor and that area experienced, it's just day and night. And so if a dolphin can just move, you know, 30 miles away, 20 miles away even, it would be okay.
Yeah, and speaking of Shaw, actually, Jill is curious to hear whether or not you think your education center will be rebuilt in the future.
Mm-hmm. Yes, actually. Better be. We are right now in the process of figure out, and we are really excited that we're in the process of making plans for rebuilding. And if you're out there and you follow us, we have some really exciting ideas, and it's going to be bigger and better than ever, and it's just going to we're going to do even more for the environment of Abaco and bringing in our young environmental ambassadors, and hopefully have a place where everybody who loves Abaco can come and learn more about it. It's an exciting time for us.
That does sound exciting. I'm glad you'll be able to rebuild. Now, we had another question, and this is kind of interesting, I guess, for those of you in the path of the storm. One of our viewers was curious whether or not any of your data was lost. You lost, like, hard drives or, computers.
Well, we, as a safety mechanism, we back up all of our data, mostly to the cloud, but because you may have noticed some of our internet is not perfect in the Bahamas. For really heavy load of data, we put it on hard drives, and to be safe, we don't store it in the same building, so we stored it in the bank's safety deposit box, and the bank was completely underwater. So we lost all that data, but it was just a backup, and our house wasn't destroyed. So I guess we need to get faster internet and use the cloud more.
Yeah, it was a good lesson. You think you have a safe place to house your backup, and you really need to be in kind of different, in this day and age, kind of different continents. Even.
Yeah,
it's we lost a whole bunch of stuff at Friends and Environment, and you know, we thought they were safe, and completely wiped it all out. All the files, you know, hard files, and you think you're going to cover with plastic and put it up on high shelves and whatnot, and just completely wiped out. And you know, not only us in the environmental world, but you can imagine that you know, all the doctor's offices, you know, my doctor's in the Bahamas and, you know, are in Abaco, and I have no medical records because my medical records were, you know, I probably had a hard copy medical records and hard drives, and they're all gone. And same with lawyers' offices and banks, you know, and so yeah, it's crazy when you start imagining the loss, and it just decimated a lot of businesses and yeah, lots of loss.
Yeah, that's really difficult, you know, I think sometimes for people to understand, even though here in Florida, we're used to hurricanes, but we do have that option of moving to higher ground or moving inland. And if you're on an island, of course, you don't have that, you know, that as a backup. One of our viewers is actually asking which areas were impacted the most. Maybe if you could talk about where on Abaco. I know you touched upon it a little bit already with Charlotte and Diane saying that you guys were further south, but what were the areas affected the most?
I'll start with that. Everyone can add on to it. But in Abaco, probably the worst area that was hit was Marsh Harbor, and which is kind of like the epicenter of Abaco. It's right in the middle. It's where, kind of business took place. The big grocery stores, all the banks are located in Marsh Harbor, doctor's offices. I mean, doctor's offices, there's clinics elsewhere. But as far as businesses, and then the shorelines in Marsh Harbor, their houses are gone. And there there was an area that a lot of less fortunate people lived, and it completely wiped it out. And people don't even know where those people are. And so that was really like huge freight boat came from somewhere and was sitting in the middle of Marsh Harbor. And it just, you know, I think that as well as huge like tsunami-like waves. I mean, I was always told that we would never have a tsunami here. And I don't know how else to explain, you know, the 20 feet of water that just rolled over that area in Marsh Harbor and took out homes and businesses. And so that, to me, and I honestly haven't driven all of Abaco yet, but that was probably the most damaged. Marsh Harbor, Treasure Key, and then the small towns in between, and several others just north of Treasure Key were just decimated.
In terms of the cleanup efforts, some of our viewers were asking whether or not salvage companies get involved in that sort of thing, especially also in the marine environment, or whether or not there might be scuba dives that could help with this. And if there's any information at all, how people might be willing to, able to help you guys with some of these activities, I think people are interested in finding out more.
Let me go again. Sorry, I keep interrupting. I do know that there were some companies that have helped. It's expensive to hire a salvage company. So some of the resorts areas have hired salvage companies to come in. We have actually, Friends of the Environment, I mean, I've talked to salvage companies to try and put together marine debris removal programs, but it's expensive. And so funding is definitely needed. Working together with these other groups now, the UNDP and Idea Relief, I think that it's really going to help go forward, and just having these other strong organizations behind the marine debris removal. And I do know that there were other organizations that were in here in the beginning when we went to the debris removal or the debris meetings that were put together. There were several different organizations coming in that were trying to get the contracts to do debris removal. But then there's local companies also that, you know, that they're trying to get the contracts. So there's definitely politics involved and competition. I mean, it's crazy. I never imagined those kinds of things would happen. You know, I just was like, I just thought, well, if somebody wants to come in and help, then let's let them help. But it's just not that easy. And but honestly, if, you know, if there's people out there that are listening and you have ideas and you have connections, we are willing to, we would love to talk to you. And or if you've done this kind of work before, please reach out to us. I think our websites are up there, maybe our email addresses. But you know, I know it's a long time out, and you know, we think over a year later problems are solved, but you know, it's gonna be a long time before problems are solved, and there still be problems out there. So we're so willing to have conversations with anybody that's out there that's still willing to help.
Yeah, you brought up a really good point, which is just, you know, the difficulty of just getting access to the sites. I know even you scientists, those of you not based on Abaco are, you know, dealing with that challenge right now, especially given COVID. And, you know, shifting gears a little bit, there's a question for either Craig or Krista, and someone would like to know whether or not there's anything you can do to de-bleach corals that have bleached.
There's really not. What happens when they bleach, when they get rid of that zooxanthellae, the way they recover is, one, whatever caused the stress to start with, whether it was temperature or something else, goes away. So environmental conditions improve. And then it's just a natural process of the coral taking in new zooxanthellae to help it recover. The one thing that I should add too is that when corals bleach, even if they do recover, they've got a lot of stress. Their immune system that they have is compromised. They're more vulnerable to disease and other things. So it's really, even if we can't do anything about the bleaching or de-bleach them, making sure that they have good conditions where they can recover and thrive without being exposed to other stressors is the key.
And I know we talked about this a little bit earlier, but how long do you expect it will take for some of these reefs to truly recover? And what kind of impact does not having healthy reefs actually have on human communities?
So I'll answer the first part of that and let Krista talk about the second part. But recovery is going to be a long time for some of these reefs. Corals are generally slow growing. And some of the coral, like on Mermaid Reef that were moved, were almost the size of a Volkswagen. I mean, these were decades or hundreds old. And not really a good way to speed up the recovery of that. We can help bring in new corals. We can use some restoration techniques to speed up the process somewhat. But it will take some of these reefs decades to recover, if they recover from the storm.
Sorry, Alexa, can you remind me the second part of that question?
Sure, yeah. What's the importance of coral reefs to human communities? Why does it matter that we have reefs, you know, and which is, of course, particular of impact for you guys living in island communities?
Yeah, so, you know, the Bahamas, we are an archipelago. We're surrounded by water and reefs. So corals provide us with numerous benefits, healthy reefs, ecosystems. So coastal protection, so really healthy reefs that are structurally complex and intact help to kind of buffer a lot of that wave energy and action that comes during storm events like hurricanes. So that's one way they benefit. They're also really important for us in terms of the value they provide for fisheries, but also for tourism, recreational opportunities, so people that are involved in tours, tour operating businesses, so snorkeling, diving, recreational fishing. And then there are also sort of untapped benefits that, you know, we are beginning to explore, have explored previously or potentially could explore in the future in terms of other benefits, medicinal benefits that reefs and other organisms that are associated with reefs potentially provide to us as well. So it's really important that we have healthy, intact reef ecosystems, because those are important for fisheries, but they're also important for coastal protection and aesthetics and our cultural values as well.
And one of the questions we've received is actually whether or not, when it comes to restoration efforts that you guys are involved in, are there any lessons learned from Hurricane Dorian that might actually help you guys as you move forward with, regrowing some of these coral reefs?
Yeah, I think there are lessons learned, and we're still learning some of those lessons. We do know, one, that a lot of the reefs that we have been restoring in different parts of Abaco, the corals that we outplanted to the reefs from our nurseries did quite well and did survive through the storm. So we know that we're not just putting corals out there and the first storm that comes away is going to knock them down. We also, right literally the week before the storm, had been working with coral spawning and had settled larvae to these substrates that we put out on some reefs like Mermaid Reef. And we are now going back and seeing, where did we succeed with that? Where were these substrates, these little cement triangular shaped things, where did they actually stay put versus where did they get totally washed away by the storm? So we'll know a little bit better on where we can use that technique for restoration versus needing to use other techniques.
And I know we've talked a lot about Abaco, but obviously the storm also had severe impacts on Grand Bahama Island. Are there any restoration efforts for coral reefs that you guys are involved in or that you know of that will be taking place?
So we're involved with some coral restoration in Grand Bahama, and there's a for-profit business called Coral Vita that's growing corals to help restore reefs as well, that's based out of Freeport, Grand Bahama. An issue that we've seen with Grand Bahama after Hurricane Dorian, though, is the spread of a disease called stony coral tissue loss disease. We did not detect it in any of our pre-Hurricane Dorian surveys of reefs around Grand Bahama. We actually didn't even detect it 6 weeks after the storm, but this past March we were out and surveyed reefs throughout the southern coast of Grand Bahama, and almost all of the reefs, all the reefs that we went to and almost all the reefs present along the southern coast were infected with this devastating disease that has wiped out coral throughout the Florida Keys. So we think it wasn't brought there by the hurricane, but the hurricane might have accelerated its spread. It might have made conditions on the reefs such that they were more vulnerable to the disease. But that plus COVID and our inability to get back out there has hindered some of the restoration efforts for Grand Bahama due to this disease, and then just our inability to get out because of COVID.
Yeah, that makes sense. Also, another question related to coral reefs is whether or not any of your data is publicly available. I don't know, Krista, do you guys share your data? Is it like open source or network?
You can go ahead, yes. Krista.
So the methodology, sorry, Craig, you wanted to go ahead?
You got it.
Okay. So the methods that we use to collect the data pre and post assessments are based on the Atlantic and Gulf Rapid Reef Assessment Protocol. So all of that information is uploaded into their database. We also prepared a report, a preliminary report and a final report following our initial assessments of Grand Bahama and Abaco, and that's available on our website as well. And we are working on getting that ready to publish. Hopefully it'll be submitted this year and published next year.
And it was kind of a follow-up.
I was just going to say, to add to that, we also have been doing these coral reef report cards for the Bahamas over a couple of years. And the latest one that we just put out a few months ago does include a section on the impacts of Hurricane Dorian for reefs of Abaco and Grand Bahama, as well as other threats to coral reef throughout the islands. And that's all available on our website.
Are boaters coming to the Bahamas, you know, potentially able to help you guys in collecting any data at all? Or do you have to observe very specific methods when you're doing your surveys?
For our work, we do have some very specific methods, but we also, like I mentioned with this coral disease, stony coral tissue loss disease, we are crowdsourcing. We are looking for boaters and fishermen and divers to report when and where they see that disease to us and send any pictures. And we also have a way to report that on our website so that we can get a better picture. The more eyes in the water, the better to help us find these things. So that's definitely one way that people can help out no matter what.
Perfect. Now, Charlotte and Diane, we have a question regarding your oyster work. Lisa is curious if there is a reason why you use oysters as opposed to some kind of a mechanical device that might be able to collect data for you.
Well, I think as a lot of people have mentioned, there's nothing left here. There's no shops to go and buy anything. And we recently have had some freight services open up, but we have an abundance of oysters in Abaco, and they are growing wild and relatively easy to collect. So that's why we chose oysters. And I think there are even some people use clams, but we don't have as many and they're not as easily accessible. So that's why we chose oysters. We're also putting them, when I talk about where we were putting them in the Sea of Abaco, we're putting them where oysters are, so in their natural habitat. So when we go to a destroyed area, you know, on a broken dock, there are already oysters there. And we have collected some of those, but we're doing it in you know, from the pristine areas and then measuring the time they're out so that it's a structured design. But we're actually putting them in areas where they are naturally occurring as well.
And I know you mentioned that you haven't had a chance to analyze the data yet and you know, get the oysters tested, but do you have an idea of what kind of chemicals may be polluting these areas?
So the main ones that we're looking at is PAH. It's associated with fuel mainly, and that fuel could come from sunken boats or cars, refrigerators, and oils. Those contaminants can be carcinogens. So, you know, if it got into the human food system, they're potentially cancer-causing contaminants.
We have a question from Lee. This is more dolphin-related, I think, but he's curious if veterinarians are ever involved with these kinds of events, you know, in follow-up research, and whether you guys ever work with veterinarians at all. I guess that applies to corals as well, but...
Yeah, we do. We run the stranding network in the Bahamas, and so we have a within the country anyway, and we have support from U.S. vets as well. But whenever you have a stranding, and particularly if there's a live stranded animal that needs help, then we reach out to the vets, even if it has to be remotely. So they're a huge asset for us, Our local vets in Abaco help with conducting necropsies if it's a stranded animal. And it's a different day at the office for them compared to the sort of small animal work that they normally do. And we we ran workshops to train Bahamian vets and vet techs in the methods, the approaches needed to conduct the new crop season, and also save live stranded animals. So, yeah, we work with vets.
Makes sense. Any veterinarians involved with coral reef research? I know sometimes veterinarians work in the aquarium industry.
Yeah, we do work with some vets and aquarists that are part of large public aquaria institutions. There's very few that specialize in corals, but we do work with a few that are interested in coral disease, coral spawning, and other aspects of reef health and reef ecology.
Yeah, I can add too that, I just wanted to add that when we have had the opportunity to rescue animals and rehabilitate them, then obviously the veterinary care is critical in saving that individual and helping with a successful rehabilitation and release. So that's probably the most important role that vets can play here.
Yeah, that makes sense. Another dolphin-related question actually comes from Felice. I hope I'm saying that right. But she's curious whether the bottlenose dolphins in the Sea of Abaco have been observed feeding more frequently. And if so, if you have any idea of what their prey might be.
We haven't conducted foraging studies directly. We're mostly, when we're working up there now in particular, we're trying to cover as great an area as we can to photograph as many different individuals as possible. So we have a large enough sample size to estimate their abundance at the end of the year. But we do know that they feed on, and since the hurricane, we've seen them feeding on jacks like they used to. And these are smaller jacks, like bar jacks and blue runners, you know, small species. They also forage in the bottom substrate and collect razorfish and sand codfish in some cases. But they do have quite a diverse diet here. They can also feed on snappers and plants and different species.
I know one of the videos that we showed earlier showed a dolphin with shark bites. And I'm not sure if this question works for any of you guys, but one of our viewers is curious how shark populations have been impacted since the storm. Do any of you guys know?
No, we've been recording every sighting of shark that we have had during our surveys. I know there's several people who have done shark studies in Abaco before Hurricane Dorian. Beth Whitman is one of those people, and they are keen to get back here and do follow-up work. But unfortunately, COVID has really limited their ability to do follow-up studies, and also for turtles as well.
In terms of climate change, several viewers were curious if you foresee events like this getting worse moving forward as climate change progresses.
I am not a climate change scientist, but I think the evidence does suggest increased frequency and intensity of storms, increased water temperatures, and a whole host of other things that are direct threats to corals and other marine species. Yeah.
Yeah, I'd agree for sure.
Are there any particular impacts that it might have on marine mammals? Would that be just impacting the prey and where the prey moves, or?
That's correct. It won't have as great an impact for marine mammals that live in the subtropical and tropical regions as it will for those in higher latitudes and arctic regions. But yeah, shifts in prey abundance will definitely have an impact.
And I think this next question is particular for those of you living in the Bahamas. Are there any plans to collaborate on policies that will help to mitigate the damage from future storms and any other anthropogenic impacts? I don't know if you guys work closely with the government or.
We had a natural history conference scheduled for May that all of the people on this call were going to be part of a workshop that was going to discuss exactly that. You know, what are the lessons we've learned from the hurricane? How can we be better prepared for the next one? What do we need the government's help with? But the conference didn't happen, and the workshop didn't happen. The conference happened virtually. But it is definitely something we have discussed, and we need to, whether it's more access to funding or quicker permitting to allow scientists in following a hurricane, a data repository where, you know, where we had access to baseline seagrass data and could then go and survey the correct areas so that we can do a comparison. You know, more of a data repository to have all that baseline data so that people on the ground can quickly get out to the environment and do assessments, whether it's the marine or terrestrial. You know, there was quite a huge effort doing bird assessments as well. But no, we haven't put any of it into, you know, into certain steps, but it is something we were discussing with the National Trust, and we did have government scheduled to attend the workshop as well. So yeah, we should probably get back on that.
Chris, anything you guys? No, go ahead.
Well, just from our end, we have been working again as part of a project that the Bahamas National Trust has funding for to develop a biophysical monitoring plan for the Bahamas National Protected Area System. And that would include some aspects in terms of being able to monitor the effects due to storms, due to other natural or other kinds of disasters that may happen, to be able to do these rapid assessments and to report back and to be able to provide recommendations. But that aspect of it, obviously, as Charlotte mentioned, does require funding to actually implement. So that's something, that work is ongoing. But in the interim, there are steps that I think a lot of people are already aware of. There have been lots of conversations this year and last year, and marches and protests about the state of climate and the crisis that we're currently facing. So people, I think, have access to information to help them incorporate certain strategies, changes, small actions in their daily lives that can help to mitigate some of the stressors that reefs and some of the other habitats are experiencing.
And we have one other question real quick for Charlotte and Diane related to your oyster research. Mallory is curious if you're aware of any similar research to oyster and contaminant studies being done adjacent to oil drilling and or whether there are leaks and oil impacted mangrove corals or seagrass beds. I guess that's probably yes. Referring to grant.
Well, I think she may be referring to the upcoming oil drilling that the Bahamas is expecting, possibly even as soon as December. And we have had discussions on putting an acoustic recorder out in that area to start monitoring the area for marine mammals and fish. But it's an interesting idea to put oysters in that area to potentially capture any leaks. It's quite a deep area, so I'm not sure. I don't think they'd let us put it on the actual structure. But I know that some oyster projects in the past have collected near oil sites, but I don't know those studies in depth.
Yeah, and in the oysters are being used to clean up areas in the southeast, and I think to some extent in the Gulf States as well.
Yeah.
Can you tell us a little bit more about the planned drilling, just briefly? I know it's a little off topic, but just so people kind of have an idea of what's happening.
So there's the Bahamas Petroleum Company has a license. They've already done some exploratory search for oil, and they're due to start an exploratory drilling well this week, I think on Monday, they announced that they hope to drill in December before Christmas. They seem open to talk to the environmentalists, and there's a group that have formed petitioning the work. From the little we know, certainly the marine mammal, the environmental impact assessment that you would do before has not been done and is not scheduled to be done. It's not regulatory, but it is a guideline. So from our angle, we would like more involvement in how many marine mammals are in the area. We did release a rehabilitated spotted dolphin to Bimini recently, and because it had a tag on its back, we were able to track it over a long period, and it did go to that area where the drilling well is and use that area for a number of days. So we know from that information that marine mammals are in the area. We don't know enough about, but we have heard that a lot of the oil will not be used in the Bahamas, and also that most of the employees will not be Bahamian. So it's again questioning the cost benefit. What do we get as a country out of it other than a huge risk? You know, as you know, Florida have stopped all new wells, and that's for a reason, and we're very close to Florida. Hopefully there will be more of an open discussion with the company and the environmentalists, but from the little we know at the moment, it doesn't obviously seem like a win for the Bahamas.
Yeah, it's but the test drill site is between the western most part of the Great Bahama Bank and Cuba, and there is concern that's been raised in Florida, because the way, if there is a spill or any oil leakage, it's going to flow north up towards the Florida coast, and will be more of a problem for Florida potentially than actually for the Bahamas. Mm-hmm. So yeah, Americans and certainly South Floridians should be following this very closely.
Yeah.
It's kind of a scary thought to think to have, you know, that thrown into the mix on top of everything else, all the other environmental challenges that our reefs and habitats are facing. One of the overwhelming questions we keep getting over and over is different people asking how they can help, like especially, I guess, for those of you on the ground. You know, what can people do, whether it's donations or just maybe get involved in some of your work? Maybe if you kind of want to go around and how people could help with, you know, the work that you guys are doing in the Bahamas.
Sure. So donations are always appreciated. We're all working for nonprofit organizations, and we're always struggling for funding to do the good things that we want to do. So that's always appreciated. We also have within the Bahamas established what we're calling the Reef Rescue Network, where recreational divers can get involved in helping restore coral reef sites throughout the islands, including places in Abaco and Grand Bahama that were affected by Hurricane Dorian. But really, almost every island where there's diving in the Bahamas, we have a presence there and are starting to do coral restoration on the reefs. And then also anyone just coming to the Bahamas as a visitor, helping us track the spread of this stony coral tissue loss disease is another good thing that anybody can do. There's a couple different ways to report it, and we're gonna hopefully in the short term have posters and flyers about how to report these things at ports of entry into the Bahamas, whether you're coming in by boat or coming in and staying at a hotel or resort. There should be ways that we can, that you can get information to us to help us with our research and monitoring and conservation efforts.
Chow, what about you guys?
As Craig said, donations are always appreciated because we are all working for nonprofits. And people who visit the Bahamas, I mean, I think most people come here because our environment is beautiful. Even after Dorian, people still want to come, and we are rebuilding. And come and enjoy our environment and continue to be good stewards of our environment, be responsible stewards, and so that we continue to have this incredible environment for our children and for future generations. And as far as Friends of the Environment, go on our website, friendsoftheenvironment.org. We just built a new website. It's pretty cool. Sign up for our newsletter and be involved with the Abaco environment and follow what we do. And when we have our new learning center built, come and visit us. And I think it's gonna be a really great destination, and you'll probably see a lot of work that Charlotte and Diane are doing, and Krista and Craig. We do a lot of work with them, and always like to incorporate what they're doing as well as other research that's going on around Abaco. So just come and be involved, sign up for our newsletter, and donate. That would be awesome. Thanks.
What about you guys?
Yes, we also welcome donations. but we also, like Craig, we do have welcome sightings from anybody that's cruising the Bahamas, whether it's in Abaco or anywhere within our waters. And on our website, there's information that shows you how to report those sightings. We had a sighting report just a few days ago of a group of killer whales between here and Nassau. So there are some really exciting animals you can come across out there. Just keep your eyes open. And if you are in the Abaco and do see bottlenose dolphins, please do try to take photographs of the dorsal fins, and we may be able to use those as part of our annual census work.
And also just remember that, it's happening more and more, unfortunately, but now every time we cut open a dead whale, there's plastic in its stomach. So I don't know who came up with the expression, but don't splash your trash. It's the whales and dolphins certainly end up ingesting it.
I'd like to also mention that one of the ways that you can help all of us in Abaco and Grand Bahama is by contributing to the nonprofit groups that have donated their time. And most of them are Americans that have come here, All Hands and Hearts, Samaritan's Purse. I mean, these groups are just incredible. They've been here for over a year now, and COVID has affected their ability to work, but you know, it's people like us. They sign up and join these organizations and use their vacation time to come and help knock out people's homes that are just destroyed. It's been a humbling experience to see how kind humanity can be.
And in terms of your organization, I know Chad just told us where people can find more about Friends of the Environment. Where should people go to learn about the Bahamas Marine Mammal Research Organization?
Yeah, so our website is Bahamas Whales. And I think throughout this evening, there's a lot of reference to BIMRO, which is basically the acronym of the Bahamas Marine Mammal Research Organization, and all of our social media is at BIMRO, BMMRO. So we're on the three main: Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. And we get some pretty cool photos, so I think it's a fun thing to follow.
Craig and Chris, I want to make sure we get you all's contact information out there as well.
Go ahead, Krista.
We are also, we have our website, it's ANGARIinstitute.org, and we're also on social media, so Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, LinkedIn, so you can follow us at ANGARI Institute for Marine Science as well.
Well, thank you guys so much. This has been really informative, and I'm sure that our viewers got a lot out of this conversation, so thanks so much for participating tonight. I hope we have a chance to meet in person one day. You know, ideally in the Bahamas. And for those of you watching at home, if you're interested in some of our upcoming events, please go to changingseas.tv and click on the events tab at the top of the page. We have a screening coming up in November with our friends in Hawaii related to humpback whales. Also, if you'd like to learn more about the ANGARI Foundation, please go to ANGARI.org. And just a huge shout out to our team behind the scenes who've been working hard. We have about 8 people working to make this happen tonight. So thanks to all of you. And yes, thank you for watching. Stay safe. Bye.